One of the things that you've been working on, you're a member of an interagency working group that's been looking at the land tenure and specifically at Ghana as well. So while we wait to hear back from Nana, perhaps you could talk a little bit about the work that you've been doing there and how, from your point of view, land tenure insecurity is you know, holding back economic growth.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, let me start by giving you a little bit of background on the broader process that our interagency working group came out of, and that was the Partnerships for Growth Initiative. The Partnerships for Growth Initiative came out of the Presidential Policy Directive on Global Development, and the idea is for the United States and partner countries to sit down and sort of engage in an in-depth, collaborative, rigorous kind of process to really look at the evidence, look at the whole economy of these countries, and figure out what the priorities should be, and figure out what we see as the overall constraints to economic growth. And the four countries that are initially participating are Ghana, Tanzania, El Salvador, and the Philippines. So we all know Ghana has experienced pretty healthy economic growth over the last 10 years, but the task of the Partnerships for Growth team was to really think about why hasn't this growth been faster, what could be done to increase the rate of economic growth and hence poverty reduction. And so following this sort of lengthy process involving people from different US government agencies, people from different ministries in the government of Ghana, the three constraints that the team identified were access to credit, electricity, right, unreliability of the power supply, and then the third one was insecure land tenure, right? So I mention this because I want you to understand that the conclusion of this rigorous analysis, right, was that insecure land tenure was one of the top three issues in terms of things that are happening in Ghana that get in the way of economic growth. Okay, so why is that? What are the mechanisms by which insecure land tenure inhibits economic growth? Well, I'll flesh out a little bit some of the points that Richard and Jolene have already raised. But basically, we see sort of three main avenues. One of them is in terms of investment from small-scale farmers. The second is in terms of land transactions. And then the third is in terms of other broader kinds of investment. So probably most importantly is the first one, and that's that insecure land tenure deters investment for millions of small-scale farmers in Ghana, right? And as Richard said, this is because when somebody might take your land, or when your claim to land is subject to challenge, it weakens your incentive to invest. And particularly in Ghana, we're talking, when we talk about what are these investments, we're talking about things like investing in higher value tree crops, right? Things that might take a longer time to pay off. We're talking about small scale irrigation investments in soil conservation. And one that the research has really shown is important, particularly in Ghana, is fallowing, right? So there was a paper that showed a pretty large impact of tenure insecurity on reducing agricultural productivity by reducing the incidence of fallowing. And the reason for that is that if you leave your land fallow, then it's more subject to claims by other people. Your tenure over it is less secure. And so as a result of that, people don't fallow their land as often as they would from a purely productivity maximizing perspective. Okay, so that's the first issue. The second is in terms of land transactions, and what we mean by that is that when we have insecure land tenure, the distribution of land is not as efficient as it might otherwise be, right? And so you might imagine a household that's got lots of labor and is looking to expand the area that it cultivates may want to buy or rent land from another household that doesn't have as much labor, or another household where people are migrating to the city or something like that, right? But if the second household doesn't have secure land tenure, that kind of transaction can't take place. Okay, similarly, rental markets are very important in Ghana, where, again, households that may not have as much land as they'd be able to cultivate rent land in order to increase their holdings and increase their output. But when rights aren't secure, right, these rental transactions don't take place. And particularly in Ghana, there's often concerns that the renter of the land is then going to try to assert permanent rights because the person who owns the land doesn't have a clear and demonstrable claim to the land. So that's an issue. And the bottom line here with land transactions is that we see a situation where people who could use the land the most productively aren't able to access it, okay? And then finally, the third avenue here is in other kinds of investments. One of the things that we looked at in our interagency working group was a study of foreign investors who identified access to land as the number one constraint that they face when operating in Ghana. Okay, so the number one problem for foreign investors in Ghana, according to the investors themselves, is accessing land. And obviously, if investors aren't able to access land in one country, they're going to go somewhere else. Okay, this is also a difficulty for Ghanaian investors. Also, there's a lot that's been written about the land grab phenomenon in a lot of African countries, as Jolene touched on, these large-scale land transactions where sometimes local people are being displaced by larger commercial operators. And we believe that one of the best defenses against these kinds of abuses is when the people on the ground have clear and secure land rights. Okay, so those three things are sort of the main mechanisms by which we see land tenure insecurity as a constraint to economic growth in Ghana.